You are listening to the Fringe Radio Network. FringeRadioNetwork.com.
Listening to Earth Oddity, a weekly odyssey into all the oddity planet Earth has to offer. And now, serving it up are Christopher Tiny Sullivan and John Wong.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Earth Oddity. We thank you so much for joining us. Whether you are a doctor contacting your patients through robot,
yeah,
or if you are trying to burn down your neighbor's house because it has ghost in it, we thank you so much for joining us.
That's right. Thanks for being here again for your favorite podcast brought to you by Cajun Curl. You know, I don't know if we shout them out at the beginning enough. And
that voice you're hearing is John, the Iron Long.
That's right.
My longtime co-host. Thank you for joining us.
I'm officially taking my name out of world's biggest Birmingham Iron fan. They've lost two games in a row. And I'm jumping off the bandwagon.
Oh, so, man.
Yeah. I'm throwing my support behind the Orlando Apollos.
So okay.
That's Steve Spurrier's team. Since Birmingham didn't give me any love at all. So I made a guy mad on the Birmingham Iron page last night on Facebook. I just made what I thought was a pretty funny comment. I was like, first back-to-back losses in franchise history. That's not too shabby if you ask me, which I thought was a little lighthearted joke.
Yeah.
He got mad and he was like, there's always one in every crowd, you know, and how many games have you been to? And I was like, I've yet to miss a home game, which was an outright lie.
This is why you can't win an argument online, people.
That's right. Exactly. It was an outright lie. I've yet to go to a home game and never will go to a home game.
Because they let you down.
Yeah, right. Yeah, they let me down. Well, first of all, they didn't jump on board with me being the world's biggest fan first. Right. So, yeah, so I'm done with them. I'm done.
Doggone it.
Done.
Well,
although they made a quarterback change yesterday and they played, the offense looked a lot better. But you're going up against like Steve Spurrier, who's one of the top coaches in the history, definitely of college football.
Right.
Not so much in the NFL, but I mean, he's coaching circles around these guys because he knows what he's doing. So anyways, this is not an AAF podcast.
No.
And I'm sure people are tired of hearing me talk about it. So
John, you burned bright.
Yeah.
You burned hot.
Yeah.
But all good things must come to an end.
Well, you know, I latch on to something and I will get really fired up for it. And then I drop it with the same passion that I was like on fire for it with.
Yeah.
So that's why I don't get tattoos, because I would have gotten a Birmingham Iron tattoo. But I know that sooner or later I won't be into it anymore. There's really only been like two or three things that I've ever kept up with my whole life. So everything else just comes and goes.
Well, I'm glad to see that the podcast still interests you.
Yeah, it's still here. Still doing it. You know, and that's because I enjoy it. And I enjoy the people that we interact with, and I enjoy you.
Yeah.
And I got to have somewhere for all these crazy thoughts in my head to go. So why not out to millions of people that will judge me based solely off of stories I tell
about myself.
Well,
there's a demand. There's a demand for John Long's random deep thoughts.
Yeah, right. True. I guess. So, yeah. Maybe I should make just a separate deep thought podcast. I should do that like on Anchor or something while I'm driving around.
Yeah.
I have some pretty weird ones that come into my head. So,
well, speaking of burning hot and bright, fornication is now legal in the state of Utah.
It's Californication.
All right.
Did you know that?
I did not know that, but I'll be making a vacation plans to get out there soon.
Headline here. This comes from Fox 13, Salt Lake City. Fornication will no longer be illegal in Utah.
Dream of Californication.
Okay.
In a bill cleaning up Utah's criminal code, lawmakers repealed the misdemeanor crime of fornication. Hmm. The House passed Senate Bill 43 on a 41-32 vote.
Oh.
It previously passed the Utah State Senate, and it now goes to Governor Gary Herbert for his signature or veto. The legislature previously passed a bill removing adultery and sodomy among consenting adults as crimes in Utah, Representative Paul Ray of Clearfield said that court rulings have found the laws are unenforceable and it was time to remove them from the books.
Well, I like that move, taking them off of the books.
Yeah.
Because Alabama has the largest, longest state constitution because we just keep adding on to it.
Yeah.
The process to remove a law is so complex, they don't even do it anymore.
Says here that the bill wasn't popular with some of the more conservative members of the Utah House of Representatives. Representative Merrill Nielsen of Grantville said that he objected, and so did Representative Kevin Stratton. What is legal? This is a quote here. What is legal is often far below what is morally right, Representative Stratton said. And I recognize our laws are not strong enough to rule an immoral people.
Okay.
Boom. Kind of threw down the gauntlet.
He did.
The people
did.
Of Utah.
But I would
we
say.
We can't rule over you immoral heathens.
It's Californication.
I would say I kind of agree with him there. You know, like you're not, we're ruling an entire society, not just, you know.
Right.
So you might have to take in consideration on shifts of opinion for the majority of your society. Now, I don't know, in Utah, I mean, I just thought it was all Mormons and drinking Kool-Aid and, you know, like hanging out and singing Jesus songs. So they may be a little different than it is here in Alabama. Number 11 in the sinful, most sinful states. So,
like, yeah. He says that the laws are unenforceable. And
well, I'd say you gotta, I mean, like, how do you catch? I don't know how you would catch somebody. You know, is it just like a dad calling up because his daughter got pregnant or something and now having the boyfriend arrested?
I mean, I wonder what would the penalty be? It's a misdemeanor charge.
Yeah, I imagine just a fine. Yeah, I would imagine so. But Utah's kind of weird. You know, my cousin lives in Utah. He lives in Park City. And we went out there once. Really one of the cleanest states I've ever been in. Mm-hmm. Got to give it to them out there. Alabama is like trash central.
Yes.
People litter in Alabama like crazy. It's the most frustrating thing in the world. But Utah is like clean, everything like a postcard.
They
Everybody's
probably don't
nice.
Even have to put up no dumping signs.
Yeah, right. Yeah, so people aren't leaving like their freezers that quit working like on the side of the highway. You know, really wild. As I say this, I have a huge pile of trash out in front of my house too. But we have bulk trash
pickup. Well, you're from Alabama.
Yeah, we have bulk trash pickup once a week. So we're getting ready to sell our house. So we did a lot of cleaning up this week.
Oh, congratulations. Have you got another one picked out?
No, we don't. Oh. Now, we have a few that we got our eye on.
Okay.
But we got to sell our house before we can do anything.
Gotcha.
And if we have to live with my mom for a while, mom and dad for a while, then we will while we find another place to go.
Gotcha. So,
but there's a few we've checked out. But
okay.
Who knows if we'll be able to get them. Who knows if anybody will buy our house? If you're listening to this, just make a little plug. If you're looking for a really nice house in a really great neighborhood, great elementary school, probably the top elementary school in this county, come on down and see me. Just holler at me, shoot an email or something. We'll work something out. You know, 3-bedroom, 2-bath, got a bonus room. It's a study, but we turned it into an extra bedroom. Huge garage. Got a shop that's brick too out back. You could put another car in that if you wanted to. It's a, you know, pretty nice little house. I happen to love it. We just need an extra bedroom because we're doing this foster parent thing and we need an extra spot to stick a kid. So
gotcha.
We're going to have to get a bigger house. So,
well,
I don't know how we got from.
I know. I hope that works out for you.
From fornication to me selling my house. But yeah, somebody buy my house, please. Please. We'll make you a deal on it.
Before we move on, we'd like to say, and now this is just going out to our fellow brothers and sisters in Christ.
Yeah.
Fornication is still against God's law.
Absolutely.
Maybe legal in Utah.
Absolutely.
Still against God's law.
Yeah. Yeah. No. Yeah. That hadn't anything changed. At least when I was flipping through the Bible this morning at church, I didn't see that had been stricken from the
I don't
record.
Have the latest translation yet, but I'm pretty sure it hasn't changed.
I'm pretty sure every Baptist youth group in the world is pointing that out on a regular basis. At least that's how it was when I was a teenager. That was always one of the hit lessons. So, but what you do is you marry the person you love, and then you have a relation with them as God intended.
Yeah.
And our next story here is about a loving couple. It's from Florida, one of our favorite states.
Can't wait.
Yeah, clickorlando.com. The headline reads, Florida woman shot boyfriend for snoring too loudly, deputies say. Oh, so they were fornicators. I thought they were married.
It's Californication.
That's what you get.
Yeah. Lori Morin of Coca was arrested on an attempted murder charge. She was 47-year-old, and she tried to kill her boyfriend because he snored too loudly, sheriff officials say. Now, I have a CPAP, and I don't snore anymore because I have, like, air forced into my nostrils. Because you have that
Darth Vader apparatus.
Yeah, right, yes. I'd like to think of it as a fighter pilot. Me and Dieter play Top Gun every once in a while, you know. It's like coming in for a landing, baby. Get ready, you know. But am I clear to buzz the tower, you know? But anyways, but when I did, one of my biggest complaints was, like, she would, like, hit me and kick me and stuff to get me to wake up. And I'm like, why can't you do this nicer? You know, like,
yeah.
Well, reach over and squeeze my butt. I will stop snoring if you do that. Like, why do you have to be so violent about it? But anyways, I'm glad she never tried to shoot me. Deputies said the shooting was reported Wednesday night at a home on Emerald Lake Drive in unincorporated Coca. The victim was taken to a local hospital where he is in stable condition. The Brevard County Sheriff's Office said Friday that Lori Morin was arrested on charges of attempted murder and aggravated battery. A preliminary investigation that included statements from Morin and her boyfriend indicated that the shooting was accidental.
Huh.
I don't believe that.
Yeah.
According to the sheriff's official, an ongoing investigation determined, however, that the shooting occurred during a domestic violence incident between the couple because the man was snoring loudly. The dispute escalated, and Morin retrieved and fired a shotgun.
Dang.
Like a .22 pistol or something.
No, she went straight to the big stuff.
That's right. Striking her boyfriend, deputies said. Morin and the man had been drinking prior to and during the argument, deputy said. Surprise, surprise. Which
these stories always involve drinking.
Drinking will put me out too, and I'll snore bad. I mean, I don't really drink a lot anymore, but I know what he was going through. I've talked to her a couple of times, and she's always been really nice. And so the news is kind of shocking on it, honestly, said neighbor Samantha Bobbier. To hear that it was over snoring is kind of shocking. It's kind of crazy. Another neighbor, Robert Mason, said, it's so stupid and so bizarre that I can't imagine that kind of behavior. A neighbor told News 6 they watched as Morin was arrested. They must have been waiting for her. She pulled in, and then all the cars came rushing out of every direction, neighbor Alan Gosser said. And so she's held at the Brevard County Jail without bond. And her picture, she's not really a looker. I was going to say that much.
She should just be happy that she's got a boyfriend. Yeah.
Looks like the Crypt Creek Keeper from the old Tales from the Crypt. I'm not trying to be mean or anything. I'm just trying to paint a picture for our listeners.
Hey, this lady shot somebody.
Exactly.
Okay?
Right. Over
snoring. We don't have to be nice to her.
Right. Exactly. Yeah, it's not a looker, you know. I feel like for the boyfriend, I mean, I'm sure he probably wasn't a looker either. You don't really see that kind of disparity.
Maybe she's got like a really nice personality,
I bet.
She didn't that night.
No, but having, you know, like I said, when Deidre used to punch me and everything else, you know, I kind of realized that maybe if the shotgun was handy, she might would have pulled it on me a couple of times. And I sleep like a log. I mean, I still do. I lay down, I go to sleep. I'm usually asleep within like 5 minutes of laying down, and I sleep all night. I never wake up or anything. And then I get up the next morning, I feel great. Well, before I had the CPAP, I did that. Apparently, I was waking up or dying or something in the middle of the night. I didn't know. I wasn't aware of that.
Yes.
Woke up and felt great, but Deidre had to deal with me snoring and stopping breathing and everything else.
Huh.
I just don't know why she couldn't be more nice.
Well, do you
it.
Sleep better or worse now that you have the CPAP?
I can tell no difference at all. And don't tell Dr. Geyer that, but I don't feel any better or worse now than I did before.
That was just a way to get some insurance to pay out some bucks.
I guess so. I feel like that was it. You know, like I've been rooked into this whole thing. But surprise, surprise, Deidre started snoring after.
Uh-oh.
Well, she may have snored all along and I just didn't notice. But when I was getting used to the CPAP, because it took me a while to get used to wearing it.
Right.
I would be laying awake. Because like I say, I'm normally asleep within 5 minutes. And I started
noticing.
Now
you got this machine hooked up to your face.
That's right. Yes. Just forcing air. It's so cruel. Like, why can't I die in my sleep? You know?
Yeah.
Like, I just wanted, everybody wants to die in their sleep. So, I mean, there's only like two ways people want to die anyways. And one of them is in the sleep. And the other one involves a bed too. So.
There's
so you're saying the least that this girl could have done is not wake up her boyfriend. Yeah. Just shot him while he was snoring.
Right. Yeah. Just shoot him while he's snoring. Exactly. But yeah, you know, so then I made her get a CPAP. So boom. Now she's got to wear one. So we both got one. So like I say, it's a little fighter pilot love going on in bed sometimes. Dream of Californication. Not so bad. Not as bad as you think. You just got to have an imagination.
Okay. Well, where can I go from there? Let's see. Okay. Sadly, there was a man, there was a terminal patient.
Oh, yeah.
Who passed away recently. And I hate that. But even more than that, his doctor decided that he was going to inform him of this via a video conference in a robot.
Okay. A robot.
Yes.
Okay.
Headline here. This comes from the BBC. Man told he's going to die by a doctor on video link robot.
Oh, is this from Britain? Yes. I know the BBC's out of... So this is going to be the like number one argument everyone talks about socialized medicine. Fucking big dad, I'm sending a robot in to tell you that you're going to die.
You know what? Scratch all that. This happened in California.
Oh, okay.
So this is just same thing. Just being reported by the BBC.
Okay, yeah.
Well, anyway, a doctor in California told a patient he was going to die using a robot with a video link screen. Ernest Quintana, 78. So, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not young.
No.
It's not as old as some.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Yeah, he's had a good life.
Yeah, hopefully. He was at Kaiser Permanente Medical Center in Fremont when a doctor appearing on a robot screen informed him that he would die within a few days. A family friend wrote on social media that it was not the way to show value and compassion to a patient. I agree.
Yeah.
You know, let's see. The hospital says that it regrets falling short of the family's expectations. Mr. Quintana died the next day. Julianne Spangler, a friend of Mr. Quintana's daughter, posted a photo of the robot on Facebook and said that it told Mr. Quintana he has no lungs left. The only option is comfort care to remove the mask, helping him breathe, and to put him on a morphine drip until he dies. She later told BBC News that it was an extremely frustrating situation and an atrocity of how care and technology are colliding. I think the technological advances in medicine have been wonderful, but the line of where and when need to be black and white, she added. Mr. Quintana's granddaughter, Anna Lisa Wilharm, who was with him at the hospital, also told the BBC that she was trying not to cry. I look up and there's this robot at the door. And it said, Will Robinson, Will Robinson.
Danger, danger, danger. You are going to die.
She said that the doctor on the screen looked like he was in a chair in a room somewhere. So I wonder if he was in front of a fireplace and he had him like a little glass of whiskey. So, yeah.
Just chilling out, all kicked back.
Or what if he was on the beach? It was like a beach chair. Yeah. That's terrible.
I'm on vacation. I couldn't make it in, so I sent my robot. Yeah.
I mean, I feel like in some ways, maybe a formal letter would have been better than a robot.
Possibly. Possibly.
I mean, I guess there's no way to give that kind of news.
Yeah, this is not good.
And one day... I'm sure one day all robots everywhere will be telling humans that we're going to die.
Oh, yeah.
Or serve them.
Yeah.
One or the other.
Yeah, they're gonna put us down.
Yes.
We'll be married to them, and we'll be like doing all kind of weird stuff with robots, and then they'll rise up and take over.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is just the beginning.
And according if what I've seen in the movies is true, like, I'm sure humanity will deserve it.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to stink.
Yeah. No, yeah, it'll stink for sure.
But we're not to that point yet. The whole point, I guess, of this article is we're not there yet.
No.
And, I kind of feel with the family here. I think that should have been handled better. If that dude's doctor wasn't there, if he was on a beach somewhere in, I don't know, the Bahamas.
Right.
Maybe he should have got another doctor. It's a hospital. I'm sure they got a doctor there somewhere.
Yeah.
Should have gone
in there
and told him.
Yeah, I would think there's got to be a way to like, you call your person who's covering, you know, like, I know doctors do rotations, you know, like at Deidre's hospital. And so, like, if Dr. Che, who's her doctor, was out, then, you know, whoever's on call for their group would fill in for him if one of his patients needed something. I don't know why you just couldn't get the other guy to go in and go, hey, I'm here for, you know, Dr. Johnson or whatever, and you're going to die, you know, just like a Band-Aid. I used to got to rip that off
just tell them real quick.
Now, the good news is we are going to keep you high as a kite.
Oh, yeah. We got some good drugs. We got some great drugs for you. And you're not going to worry about anything. And just enjoy your last time here. You know, watch The Price is Right on TV and People's Court and all that. And, you know, we're going to keep you comfortable.
We're going to order in some Chinese food.
That's right. Well, I say, or the Jell-O, all the Jell-O you want. Like, hospitals have a lot of Jell-O. You know, yeah. The Jell-O budget at hospitals has got to be through the roof. They will bring Jell-O with every meal.
You know, and this is kind of off the sub. This is way off the subject, but you know how you get a last meal if you're, you know, if you're getting the capital punishment.
Yeah.
Why don't we do that just for? I'm glad that they get a last meal, but you know, we should have last meals if we can get them.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, that's why I always eat whatever I want because it could be my last meal.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I'm not skimping. Do you want your last meal to be a salad? No. So I'm going to eat whatever I want. Doritos and Reese's cups. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. What would your last meal be?
Oh, man. It would probably be too long to even name it all.
Oh, you'd just go crazy with it? Yeah. I wonder if they like limit you.
What if you had a peanut butter and jelly sandwich? I know that's basic, but you had like Reese's cups in the middle of it.
Okay. You know? I like where you're going with this. I might try that when I get home. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I don't know what I would get either.
It would be like the biggest steak they got down at South's Finest Meats.
Yeah, probably. Something, you know, I'd say I would like my favorite food of all time is my mom makes the best sweet potato casserole in the world. It's actually mm-hmm. my great-grandmother's recipe.
So it would be one of those. So,
but I don't know that I would, like, force my mom to cook something for me to eat, you know, the last
even if you're going to die?
Yeah, right.
Well, that's very kind of you.
But she's probably, if I'm on death row, she's probably already very upset with me, you know.
I thought we were talking about last meals if you're just terminal.
General last meal. Yeah. If I was terminal, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I don't know what I'd make my mom do.
Dieter's over there. Counting up the, or she's getting ready to turn in the life insurance. She's been waiting on.
She's already downloaded Tinder on her phone. You know, just like sitting over there.
Setting up a profile.
Yeah. They're like swiping while like my mom's crying, cooking sweet potato casserole for me. That's pretty great. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. If I was terminal, I would probably let mom cook if she wanted to. But yeah. You know, mom's already lost one son. I don't want her to have to, you know, do any work while her next one dies. So.
You wouldn't be like, no, you don't have to cook if you don't want to. Yeah. I'm sure the potato casserole with the last marriage supper of the lamb's going to be just fine.
That's right, yeah. When I get to heaven, they'll have the best sweet potato. I'll get Mama Renfro to cook it for me. You know? Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what I would get, though. That's kind of interesting to think about. Yeah, I don't know.
Write in. Let us know what your last meal would be. Yeah.
That would be really good. We'll read it, you know, and I'll critique it.
Yeah.
You know? I don't know.
Oh, man, I would get so hungry.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, reading what everybody else wants.
Yeah, send in your last meals.
So let's talk about last meals for a second. Well, not really last meals, but just meals. Shout out to Wiltz who put this in the Facebook group. A tortilla cooking trespasser was caught outside of a Phoenix apartment. This is from Phoenix, Arizona, by the way, not Phoenix City, Alabama, anybody who's confused.
Yeah.
Imagine walking into your kitchen to find a strange man there cooking and eating your food. That's what happened to a woman and a man in their Phoenix apartment last week. On Friday, March the 1st, around 7:30 p.m., Phoenix police responded to a burglary call at an apartment near 51st Avenue and Indian School Road. Ooh, problematic name for that road. I'd like to just get an update on that to Native American School Road, okay? Wow, Phoenix.
At least it's not Redskin.
True, very true. When the officer arrived at the location, he says he saw the suspect, later identified as 31-year-old Jerry Christopher Drain, standing on the front balcony of the apartment.
Okay.
Police say that Drain had an odor of alcohol in his breath when he spoke, had bloodshot and watery eyes, slurred speech, and was unable to stand straight without swaying. Could have just said he was drunk. One of the two roommates told police that he woke up to the smell of something burning, and when they walked into the kitchen to investigate, he saw Drain standing there eating soup and attempting to cook tortillas on top of the electric stove without a pan.
Oh, man.
Alex Heron was shocked. He tried to cook like three of them because the first two burned, he said. I smelled the burning too, his roommate said. So we both went out, and I was like, oh, hey, what's going on? Trying to have a friendly confrontation, trying to be calm and everything.
You're in the dude's house, and he's like, hey, what's going on?
Hey, what's going on, buddy?
He reacted. He did. That is a very, very nice way of reacting to that whole situation.
During all of that happening, my roommate and I, we first noticed he had some sort of pocket knife, but we were smart enough to not say anything about it. The roommates didn't recognize Drain and asked him to leave and take whatever he was making with him.
These are extremely cool guys.
And he did. Heron said he left eating a can of soup and tortillas and stayed on their front balcony.
Oh, my gosh.
It was a can of some sort of potato, cheese, broccoli, chowder, according to Heron. I hate chowder, she said. The only plus side is that he got rid of it for me, she added with a smile. And she can laugh about it now, but called it crazy at the time. Of course, they called 911. But how did he get in the apartment in the first place? Heron said she came back home from doing laundry and probably left the front door unlocked by accident. It's weird. It's a terrifying experience, she said, and I'm glad we're all safe. He was arrested. Drain was arrested for criminal trespassing, and he also, surprise, had an outstanding warrant for another charge. It doesn't specify what it is. He admitted that he had been drinking and said he couldn't remember exactly how he ended up cooking in that particular apartment. he told the judge in court his dad lives at that complex. Okay. All right. Well, that happens.
So he just walked into another apartment.
Yeah. He just like, got mixed up, thought he was at dad's place, going to cook up some tortillas, eat a little soup, and he was at the wrong spot. So when I was in college one time, we walked back from the strip and we're going to an apartment. And somehow this dude just like, I guess he thought we were his group of friends and he like mixed in with us. And we like get back to the apartment and we're all like hanging out on the porch and we're like, hey, buddy, who are you? You know, like, hey. And he was like, oh, he tried to play it off. He's like, oh, yeah, it's like my friend lives right over there. And we're like, oh, okay, cool. Cause we're all about to go inside and probably do something illegal. And we didn't know who he was. And so he like wanders down there. We watch him. He like can't get in the door. And then he like wanders on. So, yeah.
Man.
Yeah. So he could have came in with us if we hadn't been paying attention, but we were all very alert.
I remember one time when I was on a vacation when I was a little kid. My grandparents took me to Panama City.
Mm-hmm.
We were staying in this hotel, and I was going up to the room to use the restroom. Then I was going to go straight back down to the pool. Well, I walked into the hotel room that was right beside ours.
Oh, okay.
By mistake.
Yeah.
And I walked in, and I see like somebody's got some McDonald's and sitting on the counter. I'm like,
excited.
I wonder who went to McDonald's. I hope they got me some, you know, chicken nuggets.
Yeah.
And then Happy Days was playing on the TV.
Uh-huh.
And I walk on in there and I use the restroom. And then I pop my head in to see, like, you know, like who's in the room. And it's some dude. I have no idea who it is. Like passed out, like lay like asleep on the bed. And that's when I noticed that I'm in the wrong room.
I'm in the wrong place.
I was like, oh no.
Yeah. One time when I was real little, we were at like the World's Fair or something, or maybe it was Disney World, and we were standing in line for something, and I turned around and hugged what I thought was my dad's leg. And I looked up and it was like a complete stranger, you know, and he laughed at me, you know, and then like my parents, like the line had moved or something. I didn't move along with them, you know, so they were like maybe a person or so ahead.
Yeah.
And so then they had to come and, you know, get me because I was freaking out. I really didn't like freak out. But yeah.
Right.
When I first hugged his leg and I realized it wasn't my dad. I thought it was my Uncle Bill, but it wasn't Uncle Bill either. It was a complete stranger. So I was like, all right. Yeah. That's the closest that ever happened to me. Something like that.
Gotcha. Do you remember a couple of weeks ago when we were talking about the Russian weapon that had the power to make people vomit and hallucinate?
Yeah.
And it may or may not have been Maroon 5's Super Bowl halftime party or yes. Halftime show.
Yes.
Well, apparently there's a Russian ship that's been spotted near Scotland, and they think that this weapon is on board. The headline here, Russian ship near Scotland. How does vomit weapon work? What kind of ship is she? Has she sailed near UK waters before? So they are very concerned.
Well, the Scots will drink a little bit too, right? So it may just be normal vomiting as a result of that.
Right. Says that the Royal Navy has been shadowing a Russian ship believed to be carrying a state-of-the-art vomit weapon.
Nice.
After it entered the Moray Firth. Three Russian support vessels were spotted off the coast of Scotland on March 4th by observers using the marine traffic tracking app. So they, I guess, can you just track Russian ships on the app now?
I guess so.
There's an app for that?
I guess so. Kind of like plane tracking, you know.
I guess
people,
so, yeah.
Whenever there's a college football coaching change, people track planes all over the United States.
Yeah, so that's true. That's true.
Maybe there's the same thing for ships. I don't know.
Well, anyway, included in the fleet of Russian vessels is a superpower new Admiral Gershov. Included in the fleet of Russian vessels is the superpower's new Admiral Gershov, which is rumored to have a vomit weapon, as well as tug Nikolai Chaiker supply ship for Elbrus and tanker Kama. Here's what you need to know.
That's a mouthful.
Russian is hard.
Yeah, it is.
Why is Admiral Gershov and what type of ship is she? Much like how the Royal Navy has Fife built HMS Queen Elizabeth, the Russian Navy have... Why did I pick an easier story? The Russian Navy have a brand new warship they are keen to show off. Her full name is Admiral Flotilla Sokozgo-Sagu.
Mm-hmm. Come on with it. Let's go.
Soyuza Gershov, and she has officially entered service in July 2018.
All right.
That's not important. I'm probably going to cut all that.
I don't know.
Does the ship have a vomit weapon, and how does it work?
That's the real question here.
The Russian Navy have reportedly developed weapons that can make their enemies vomit and even hallucinate. The Hill reported in February that contractors had installed the weapons on two warships, including the Admiral Gershov. It is said that the weapon fires a beam similar to a strobe light, which can affect the target's eyesight. So the weapon can make it harder for enemies to see at night. And during tests, about half of volunteers reported feeling dizzy and nauseous and disoriented. While 20% of the volunteers who were targeted by the weapon said that they experienced hallucinations. Are they sure that this isn't just a rave?
Yeah, I don't know.
This is not just like a party ship.
It sounds like a wild time to me.
Yeah.
This is like a real wild time.
The weapon is reportedly called the Fillin and has also reportedly been installed on the Admiral Gershov's sister ship, Admiral Katsanov.
Ooh.
So,
Admiral Katsanov.
They talk about how the ship gets its name, and then they talk about the class of ship, and then they talk about all this other stuff that we don't care about. Here's an important question. Which Royal Navy warship is shadowing her right now? Yeah. HMS Defender, a sophisticated Type 45 destroyer, is monitoring the Russian fleet this week. The Navy has said that she is keeping track of their activity in areas of national interest. HMS Defender left Newcastle on Saturday, heading northeast of Scotland to meet the Russian task group in time for them to pass the UK coastline. Mark Lancaster, Armed Forces Minister, said the Royal Navy is always standing ready to defend the UK. We will continue to work with our allies to shadow Russian ships passing through international waters close to our shores to ensure the Russian Navy follows correct protocol on its journey. So
do they, the Royal Navy ship, it like is loaded with Pepto-Bismol or something to counteract it? Yeah. Just sprays it out.
So.
Yeah. That's what we need to happen right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
I still think that this is maybe just a party vessel. It's a rave.
Just like a party barge. Yeah. Maybe that's what it is. The Russians.
I mean, I'm sure there's this strobe light going on.
Mm-hmm.
And then people are hallucinating.
And vomiting.
And so. Vomiting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It sounds like
college. It's a party. It's a party.
Yeah. That's a Thursday night on the University of Alabama campus. So, yeah. Yeah, that's kind of wild. Let's change gears a little bit here.
All right, let's do it.
One of my favorite movies, well, I wouldn't say favorite movies of all times, but a very enjoyable movie was School of Rock. You remember that?
Yeah. I like School of Rock.
Yeah, right.
Jack Black.
With Jack Black, he puts, he's like a substitute teacher. Well, he like fakes his way into being a substitute teacher. And then he, Mr. Sneebly, you know, that was his name, I think. Yeah. And then he puts together a little rock band with all these music students, and they go on and win some kind of competition, and hilarity ensues.
Yeah, it was a battle of the bands.
Yeah, battle of the bands.
A local battle of the bands, yes. In some scene.
Yeah,
somewhere.
Right. Yeah. Yes. Well, the guy who was the guitar player, the kid who was the guitar player in that, has found himself in a little bit of trouble.
Oh no.
Yeah, it's tough to see. You know, it's hard to be a kid star, you yeah. know, in Hollywood. We've seen it happen so many times. Drew Barrymore, Leif Erickson, Leif Garrett was his name, not Leif Erickson. That was a Viking.
Okay. He got in some trouble too.
He did. Possibly discovered America too. But this comes from TMZ. A School of Rock star is caught on video stealing a guitar, and he faces 4 felonies.
Yikes.
Yeah. So the guy's name, it only says Joey in here, as if we know, you know, I guess if you're a TMZ follower, you would know his last name. But his first name's Joey.
I guess you have to go dig out your DVD and watch the credits to find out his full name.
Yes. Police were on to Joey's sticky fingers in early February because they released security footage to the public showing him swipe a Buddy Guy model Fender Strat guitar. It's a pretty good guitar. It's black with white polka dots, if you're familiar with Strats. I'm a Strat guy. You can see him holding the guitar and casually strumming the guitar before allegedly making his way out the door in early February at the Troll Music Store.
Huh.
After police released the footage, local music store owners were now on high alert. Well, on February 11th, Joey hit up Sarasota, Sam Ash Music Store, and workers recognized him. He sampled a few guitars before walking out with a $2,000 Les Paul. That was a gold top Les Paul. But this time, Joey was followed out to his car and was confronted. We're told that a few customers blocked his car so he wouldn't escape before cops ultimately arrested him. Oh, all right. Here's his name. Joey Gatos Jr.
I'm looking at his IMDb right now.
Okay. It is rocking a seriously sad tune about stealing guitars, or at least about getting busted for jacking them. He played the lead guitarist in the school band and the School of Rock, and he's facing felony charges in Florida for larceny and grand theft after cops busted him 4 times in the last 5 weeks, allegedly stealing guitars and amplifiers. According to cops, Joey is making a bad habit of walking into stores, asking to test the guitars, and walking out with the instrument without paying, and then unloading them at pawn shops. Horrible plan.
Well, you know, he is the lead guitarist of a band called Bad Racket.
So. Oh, yeah. Police say Joey's string of heists began earlier this year, and he nabbed a blue Epiphone Prophecy valued at $800, the Fender Strat, which was $699, and the gold top Les Paul for $2,000.
Says here he's an only child, so.
Okay.
He was probably, you know,
he confessed and blamed a drug problem, but however, in court, he entered a not guilty plea for the guitars, and he's yet to give a plea for the amp he stole. So, but I would have to say, if you're not hardcore, what's the line from the movie? You're not hardcore unless you're hardcore or something like that. I don't know. That's old punk rock. That's another one that's from that movie. But yeah.
It says here he was arrested in February of 2009 for DUI.
Okay.
While he was underage.
Wow.
So.
Wow. Joey has hit the rock star lifestyle pretty hard. And I hate to see that for him, but you just can't go taking guitars from a guitar shop because, you know, that's wrong. Number one, theft. That's a commandment. Not supposed to be doing that. But also because what are you going to do with a guitar that you steal from a guitar shop? Because they have all the documentation for it, all the serial numbers and everything else. And when you go to the pawn shop to sell it, then they're just going to see that it's listed as stolen and call the cops on
it. Maybe you have to go to a certain pawn shop.
Yeah, maybe there
to
is.
Unload the.
Can't go to like the Pawn Stars guy.
No.
Or something.
No, you can't go sell it to Rick.
Yeah, Rick.
He's on the up and up.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think most, I mean, I've not been in the pawn business. You know, I haven't pawned any. I pawned a camera once, but I was just.
Was it yours?
Yeah, it was. It was. I was trying to keep my lights on in college, but it didn't work. Spent it on weed or something, and then my lights got cut off. But that's a whole other story. But yeah, they like get your ID and run all kind of, you know, checks on whatever you're pawning. At least they did back then. But yeah, I would feel like if you're going to steal equipment and sell it like that, you distill it out of the back of somebody's car. You hear that happen to bands all the time, you know. So
you want to hear something that's just heartbreaking? Here's a quote from him. "I definitely want to be a musician. That's my main thing. That's what I started out as. The acting I'm really into, though. There's really good opportunities, but if that never works out, I'm always going to have music. That's my true love."
Okay.
And now he's a thief. That's his main thing.
Well, you know, if he's got a drug problem, that's one thing. If he's just trying to make some easy cash, that's another thing. But I feel like if you could bill yourself as like, hey, I'm the School of Rock kid and I got a band, you could get a gig, you know, all the time.
I think so.
You know, regularly and get a and play, you know, as a working musician around. You may never be like a huge rock star, but most of the people who play music aren't huge rock stars, but they make a nice little living for themselves playing the bar scenes and clubs and everything else.
What year did School of Rock come out?
Oh, I don't know. Probably 2000.
Hang on 1 second.
I'm gonna guess 2004.
Close. Okay. 2003.
Okay. All right. Because I was trying to judge his age based on what he was in the movie.
Which means it's older than 15 years. Maybe we should give a shout out to the Retro Rewind podcast.
That's right.
They need to do School of Rock.
Yeah. I could come on and talk about School of Rock. Yeah. But
and we can also talk about Joey whatever his last name was.
Gatos.
Yeah, Joey Gatos.
Joey Gatos Jr. Yeah.
Gato Joey's Pickett Smith.
Yeah. So, I feel bad for him.
I know. I hope the man gets some help.
Yeah, right. But you just can't go stealing guitars.
Yeah. Maybe you ought to check out some of his music. I wonder if he's any good.
Yeah, maybe so. What was the name of his band?
Bad Racket.
Bad Racket. Ooh. That's a bad name. You need a better name than that, dude. What was the name of the band in the School of Rock?
It was School of Rock.
I bet you that's like trademarked. He can't use it. Yeah, he can't use that at all.
He could be called University of Rock.
Yeah. Let's see. Bad Racket.
Oh, Rock School.
Bad Racket Recording Studio. Hmm.
Well, I think Racket was spelled kind of funny. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I don't know. I was going to play a little bit just straight into the microphone.
Then he'll sue us for copyright.
Yeah, I think we can play like 5 seconds or something.
Yeah, I think we got 5 seconds.
Yeah, I don't know. I would just like, surely you could make your living doing other stuff, you know? I mean, just playing a normal music. Anyway, I can't find a clip of his Bad Racket on YouTube anywhere
at all. I can't find a webpage. Dude, if you're going to have a band, you got to have everybody's got a webpage.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, anyway.
Yeah, right.
We got other stuff to talk about. Let's see. How about this? Anyway, our next story here, the headline is, "Man caught trying to light a neighbor's home on fire."
Oh, okay.
Do you know why he was trying to light it on fire?
Property line dispute.
He thought it had a ghost in it.
Oh, okay. All right. That's logical. That's logical.
Stockton, California. New video shows a California man pouring gallons of diesel on his neighbor's front porch. He told police he did it because he was trying to get rid of a ghost.
Okay.
A family's security cameras captured the man pouring diesel and then trying to light the porch on fire, but the fire never fully ignites, so thank goodness.
Well, you gotta use diesel's a slow burner.
It is.
Yeah. I would have went with kerosene.
A woman and her two young children were sleeping inside the home at the time. That's where he went wrong.
Oh, yeah.
I can understand you wanting to get rid of a ghost. You
need to make sure everybody's gone.
Anyway, it says that the family called the police and they arrested the man who lives across the street. They arrested him, the homeowner said. He said that he didn't have anything against us and that he thought he saw a ghost in her house. And to me, that's just even scarier. Chong Pham, 38, is charged with arson and attempted murder.
Wow.
So, man. But you know, that brings up a question. If you have a ghost in your home, what do you do?
Call the Ghostbusters.
I was going to say, who are you going to call?
Right. You call the Ghostbusters. Exactly. Yeah, I don't know what you do. But if I was like, if you and I were next door neighbors and I was like, Tiny, your house has a ghost in it, and you're like, oh, okay, I'll be like, well, that's Tiny's problem now. I'm going to burn your house down. Yeah. You know, hey, I'm trying to help you out, buddy, by burning your house down. Yeah, I feel like there's more to this story.
Yeah, deal with your own ghost.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Handle the ghost in your house. Let your neighbor handle his own ghost. Maybe he's comfortable with a ghost there. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, but
maybe they're bros.
Yeah, right. Yeah, it's like Casper the Friendly Ghost or Beetlejuice or something.
Yeah. If it's Beetlejuice, I would burn down my house to get rid of Beetlejuice.
I don't even remember much about that movie. So, but yeah, I don't know. I think this guy had something else going on, you know?
Yeah.
That he just used that as an excuse to maybe complete his insanity or something.
Well, if that's the case, imagine. Of all the excuses that you can think of, and that's the one you're going to go with. Right, yeah. There was a ghost in the house.
Yeah. I don't know. I would have went with, like, God told me to do it. You know, that's a good, like, insanity plea one. Yeah. Just, you'll hear that from a lot of people.
I would have said that I was trying to burn it down for insurance purposes.
Now you got an insurance fraud charge on you, Tiny. You got to be smarter than that, okay?
I've never been able to think on my
feet. I would go spiders. Yeah, he had a spider problem. Everybody hates spiders. And then
black mold.
Yeah, right, black mold. That'll get you for sure. Yeah, that'll definitely get you. Yeah, I don't know. That's wild.
Yeah.
Definitely wild. But, you know, I would how do you do it and not make sure there's nobody home first? Like, just give a courtesy knock or something?
Yeah, I thought about that, too. Like, you could maybe call and say there's a bomb in the house first.
Hey, everybody get out.
Then you're trying to light it on fire, so you have to be there. You have to physically be there. You're going to get arrested as soon as they call the police and the bomb squad shows up or whatever.
Well, I know nothing about arson. You know, I have... Out of all the criminal things, that's the one I do have no experience in. But I would think in like all the like fire inspections and stuff, they would be like, somebody poured some sort of flammable liquid all over this house.
There was definitely accelerant.
Yeah, yeah, there's foul play has been involved, you know.
Yeah.
You know, so maybe we start it at the breaker box by like shoving a screwdriver in there or something. I don't know. I don't know how arson works. So
I've heard you put a bunch of potato chips on your stove. Okay. You turn the stove on.
All right. That's not a bad idea. I don't know. You know, I thought about it when the restaurant was going down several times. I just was sitting there at night and be like, how can I make this place burn? But I couldn't morally do it, you know? Like, I was just like...
Because your restaurant wasn't haunted.
Right, yeah. Well, that's a whole other story. The restaurant definitely had a ghost in it.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, now we've struck on something interesting.
Okay, anyone who worked for me that listens to this, and I bet you is no one, but I can get people to corroborate just about everything I'm about to tell you.
Okay.
No joke. All right. I noticed for years that my restaurant had a basement. We had dry storage down in the basement, like my little office, which wasn't much of an office was down there, but I would be like downstairs getting a sleeve of cups or something before we were ever open, all the doors locked and everything. And you could hear people walking upstairs.
Yeah.
And so then I would go upstairs. Of course, there's nobody up there. All right. That happened all the time. I bet you there are 100 people who could corroborate that instance right there.
Okay.
Okay. There are several other people who can corroborate seeing people in the restaurant. But there was nobody in there. So, like, we'd be sitting at the sink, and there was a kitchen door that went out to the dining room washing dishes, and you would see somebody walk by, and you just stick your head out there because you knew there was nobody in there, and there would be nobody in there. All right? So that's another thing several people can corroborate. One other thing that happened to me, that this just happened to me, but I have scout's honor. I would put my hand on a Bible. I would do whatever.
Well, I was very skeptical until you said scout's honor.
Okay.
Now I know you're being serious.
I came around. This was one morning, and
I came around the front of the counter, or like to like up where the register was. There's nobody in the store, and in between the cups that I had on the counter, I saw a kid looking at me, blonde haired kid. No kidding, I thought it was Thomas, you know, because he was like just young enough where Thomas could look over the counter.
Yeah,
so much so that I thought he was like going to sneak up and scare me. So I ran back in the kitchen and like bent down and waited for him to come around, because I was going to scare him back, you know?
were going to scare the ghost back. And ghost thought he was going
to
scare you.
There was nobody in there. All right. Oh, that 100% happened to me. All right. Last story I'll tell. We had to shut the restaurant down. Like, it was like a Saturday because they had to redo the plumbing for the whole building.
Okay.
That's a whole other story about why they had to redo it, but it involved the city, and the city wouldn't fix where there was like a dip in the line out underneath the street. So they just ran all the plumbing instead of going out front to out back into the sewage line there. Anyway, so we had to shut down. Every place down there was shut down.
Man.
Right. And
I bet that ate into your pocketbook.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You lose a day of sales. Yeah. Yeah. For real fun. Right. Make you real happy, too, when they call. And they're like, hey, we're going to finish up, and you'll be able to get open by lunch. And then they're like, nah, it's going to be all day, too. So me and my—
They don't offer you any kind of break on your taxes or anything to make up for
it. No, nothing. No, dang. That's just the way it goes. So me and Thomas and Hudson went down there because originally we were going to be open at lunch. And we're just like goofing off, waiting, you know, to be open and everything. Cause we have no water. You can't make food without water, and just health code stuff.
Yeah.
I was teaching them how to pitch quarters and things like that, and just goofing off. And then like the guy from the landlord called and said, hey, it's going to be an all day thing. We're not going to be able to open up. Hopefully you can get open on Sunday. So I'm like, all right, great. We leave, lock up and leave. Well, that Sunday, they call in the morning, hey, we're going to have to work all day, too. It's a huge job. We've busted up concrete and all this and everything. And I'm like, great. Okay, fine. So nobody goes Sunday. Finally, like Sunday evening, they call, like, you're ready to go Monday. So I go down, start doing a little bit of prep work to get ready, mm-hmm. throwing away stuff that had spoiled and all that. You know, it's been sitting for a couple of days you didn't use. And I leave, lock it up and leave. I come back in that Monday morning. There is water all over the front dining room, and there's a sink running,
mm-hmm.
and I'm like, man, did I like cut that sink on and then they cut the water on and it ran? And mm-hmm. you know, so I blame myself, immediately start cleaning everything up.
I would have blamed the city.
Yeah. Gonna have to open up and everything. Well, about 9 o'clock, the plumber knocks on the door, and he comes in. He's like, hey, just double checking, making sure everything's working right. I was like, yeah, man, my sink was running and it overflowed and had water all over the place. And he was like, man, that's weird. I came in here and checked every sink before I left, and it was closed. And he's like, all of them were off. And Brandon, who was like the landlord's little lackey guy or whatever, was like, yeah, I was with him, you know? And I was like, well, it was definitely on, because I mopped up like 800 buckets of water yeah. and shop backed up a bunch of water too and everything. And, you know, that was really kind of a bummer, guys. And they're like, well, I promise it was off. Well, Brandon goes on to the next unit, and the plumber guy's like, let me ask you a question, man. I don't want you to think I'm too weird about this. And I'm like, okay, what's up? He's like, you ever have like any ghost or anything in here? And I'm like, yeah, why do you ask? I was like, I hear people walking upstairs and I'm downstairs. He's like, well, when we were in here working yesterday, we heard kids running around, like over from inside your place. And he was like, I thought it was you and your kids. I'm like, no, we didn't come up here. And he's like, 100% me and every other plumber that was working heard kids over here playing around. He's like, I promise you, Scout's Honor. Yeah, he didn't say Scout's Honor, but.
Well, he was clearly lying.
Right.
He didn't say Scout's Honor.
And he was like, I wonder, he's like, do you think one of them could have cut the sink on? I was like, I don't know, dude, but it's very weird that the sink was on this morning. He's like, I think you got a ghost problem. And I was like, well, I guess that's what it is, but it's about time to turn the open signs on, so I got to get back to work. So there's a holy another person who heard something over in my unit, and then that water came on. So, yeah, there was a ghost there. So That's just the way it is. And anyone, I can call people right now on my phone that would corroborate that.
Well, John, I hate to tell you, but it was me.
Okay. All right.
I turned on your water.
Yes. But I mean, all of that is 100% true happened.
Wow.
The weirdest of all to me was the time I thought I saw Thomas and I went and hid. because I was that positive.
Yeah.
You know, I could explain everything else away over all the years that happened, all the weird
stuff.
Yeah,
I would say you can definitely explain it all away, but it's just the preponderance of it. The fact that it keeps on happening, it makes you.
And I don't even know how ghosts fit into like my like whole worldview, you know, that I feel like, you know, if we're absent of the body, we're in the presence of Christ, or whatever, you know. I don't know how all that works, but.
All you know is that somebody really ran up your water bill that time and cost you a lot of work.
Well, it didn't matter. We had a flat rate for water, which was way more than what it should be, by the way. But, yeah, it's flat rate because there's only one water meter for all those units down there.
Oh, okay.
So I had to pay $150 a month for water.
Golly.
It was exactly what my parents had to pay to fill up their, like, 30,000-gallon in-ground pool, you know. And there's no way I'm using 30,000 gallons in a month. But whatever. And it's illegal to resell a utility at an increased rate, but I didn't want to get into all that. I don't want
to. Did you think about like running a hose all the way from your sandwich shop to your house?
I don't know, man.
And, like, using it there too.
Well, I'll tell you a weird thing. I don't want to get anybody in trouble. There was a guy who used to have a business down in that shop.
Yeah.
And he like closed and did like a mobile car washing business. And there were several mornings when I would like take something out to the dumpster that he'd be out back filling up like this big, huge water tank out of the back spigot. And I didn't say anything at all. I was like, good, man, jack that thing up. Cause I'd like my $150 wasn't changing until my lease was going to be up. So I was like, yeah, man, run as much as you want to. Leave it on. I don't even care, you know?
Yeah.
So. Yeah, he found him some free water and was taking advantage of it, making a little more profit. So good for him. Yeah. But yeah, so anyways, there's ghosts in Timberson Square. If anybody ever needs to know it.
Did you ever talk to any of the other bar owners or restaurant owners around the area?
That's a little too crazy to talk about that. I was going to talk to the Mexican restaurant. I can't tell this story. You can edit this out if you want to. And there was a Mexican restaurant beside me for a while. This is before they switched to the new owners that have it. I guess still have it now, but had it there when I was left. And one night, I heard a bunch of like hooting and hollering in their basement because we were the only two units with a basement. Well, and there was like a drywall wall for one section in between it that had some holes in it where like plumbing pipes went through.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, what they got going on down there? So I like looked through the little hole. They're like. Never talked with anybody else about it.
Huh.
Never.
Well, anyway, I guess we'll going into our
community news.
Yeah. You want to read our ad?
Wow. I mean, honestly, straight up, all of that happened. And wow. I don't know what I believe about any of it other than I know it happened.
Is there anything in that space now?
No.
There's nothing in there.
Well, I think something's coming to it.
Okay.
Well, I just saw an announcement that some restaurant was coming to Timberson Square.
You said you were like friends with the Coppertop owner, though, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I wouldn't say friends, but he was my closest thing to a friend down there.
Yeah.
All of that crazy wild, and I don't know what I think about it, but it happened. We want to thank our sponsor, the world-famous Cajun Curl, the Bayou Blended Spice, for all of their support. Check them out at CajunCurl.com. You can order the spice and their Cajun Curl chip cutter for potatoes right there on the website. You know where it was created?
The extremely lucky Elm Bayou.
That's right.
You can kiss it. It's Irish.
And well, we know the huge Irish presence down in Louisiana.
Maybe not.
In Evangeline Parish, Louisiana, it's a seasoning that goes on everything. If you like cooking or eating, this is a spice for you. Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice goes well with chicken, beef, pork, potatoes, and anything else you can think of putting it on. The spiral potato cutter is absolutely amazing. It's easy to use, it's easy to clean, and it'll allow you to make your own chips using the Cajun Curl spice. If you want to make your next event special, whip up a batch of homemade potato chips. Nobody else is making homemade potato chips, and it's super easy. And put the Cajun Curl spice on them, serve them up. everybody will be like, wow, I'm at the best party ever. Yep. Like, this is like almost as good as a Russian party barge. So definitely need to do that. So on CajunCurl.com, you can order the Bayou Blended Spice and the Chip Cutter, but you can also find recipes that are absolutely amazing. You can locate your nearest retailer on there, or you can order your own. If your local grocer doesn't carry world-famous Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice, ask them to start stocking it today. Here locally in the Tuscaloosa Northport Metroplex, it's available at Piggly Wiggly in Northport, South's Finest Meats, and Vowels on Skyline Boulevard. All of their products are made in the USA, so not only do you enjoy the taste of Cajun Curl, but you also feel extremely patriotic while you enjoy your meal. It's all natural, it's low salt, it has a little kick to it, but it doesn't burn your lips. World famous Cajun Curl Bayou Blended Spice. Taste the spice, but not the heat. www.cajuncurl.com. Check them out and use our promo code EOP10. That's the number 10, and get a 10% discount.
Because we ask you to use the spice, but we don't ask you to pay full price.
Absolutely.
All right, we are going to have a very short community news. We don't have any new reviews, but I tell you what is happening very slowly.
Yeah.
We are starting to get some pictures to trickle in.
You know what's weird?
Earth Oddity hashtag.
You know what's weird about that?
What's weird about that?
I put up that one with Hudson and I hashtagged it Earth Oddity and it doesn't show up in the thing.
It does if you click recent post.
Okay.
For some reason, I've noticed that too.
Yeah.
If you go hit recent post, he's there.
Okay.
So maybe there's something about, I don't know, kids holding PB&J sandwiches.
Right. Yeah.
I don't know
what's up with that. So. Yeah.
But yeah, listen, everybody, this is going to the end of the month. If you would like to participate, get a free pair of cheap 50-cent Chinese disguise glasses sent to your house, take a picture, tag it Earth Oddity on Instagram.
Then turn around, hand those glasses to someone you know.
Yeah.
Have them do it too.
Yes.
Just for fun.
Because it's a challenge.
That's right.
We challenge you.
We challenge. I don't think you guys get out of it in you. I don't think y'all can do it.
And I tell you what, we're going to do this to the end of the month, but you know what? I'm feeling generous.
Yeah.
How about we get to pick the most entertaining or interesting photo and give them a prize?
Okay.
An actual good prize.
Yeah, right. Like a, a good prize.
Like a gift card or something.
Something.
Yeah. We'll figure something out.
Yeah, right. I got some old shoes that I will mail you.
Yeah,
absolutely. Got a ton of old shoes actually right now. So, yeah.
So listen, everybody, if you want a pair of glasses, all we ask that you do is give us a review and send us your address.
We'll send
them out and you just take a picture wearing them, or your kids wearing them, girlfriends wearing them.
And we are absolutely not selling your information to other advertisers, just in case anybody's worried about that. And Tiny and I are not going to show up at your house uninvited unless, you know, that's something you're into. I don't know. Yeah.
Well, then we would have to be invited.
True. Yeah.
So.
But if you're like, hey, just surprise me, you know, or something. And then we're probably not even going to do that then. So, because it's hard to get me to move off of the couch outside of work. So, yeah. But
and Sadie, in just a stroke of genius I had last week, we're going to Amazon you a pair. That's how we're going to.
That's perfect.
That's how we are going to bridge the pond.
Yeah, perfect.
And bring you into the community.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know.
Yeah.
I'm a genius.
Sadie's like the leader of our British fan club. So.
She might be like on her own.
Right. President and sole member. I wonder, I mean, just out of curiosity, maybe she'll write in and tell us, like, if she's ever, like, said, hey, you know, Jim, cheerio, whatever. I don't know what they say.
Top of the morning to you.
Yeah, fish and chips, something. I don't know. Listen to this podcast, and they've, like, came back to her, like, who are these idiots? You know? Like, I would like to get some surprise reactions from people who just unaware, you know, she's talked into listening to this. I think that would be kind of funny. Just like a whole video montage of people going, oh, who did it? Oh, Cake. Like, you remember the band Cake?
Oh, of course I
love Cake.
Sheep go to heaven, goats go to hell.
You know, they had that video back when people used to make music videos. I don't know if people make music videos or not. My music has stopped discovering new music has stopped.
I think they do, but they're all on YouTube now.
Okay. But they had a video where they were just playing their song on like a iPod or whatever, a Discman is probably for it, and like would put headphones on people and like film their reaction to it.
Oh, I remember that. Yeah.
We should get people to do that for our podcast. They were like, who are these rednecks and how do they find out how to get on the internet? So yeah, that would be funny.
Yeah.
But yeah, so just to remind everybody, if you enjoyed this episode or you enjoyed any of our episodes, and even if you hated this one and you enjoyed a previous one, tell a friend about it. Ask them to listen. Ask them to download, subscribe. That way you can make fun of us together. Y'all can discuss whether my restaurant actually had ghosts in it that caused people not to eat there and I had to go out of business. So
if you've had a ghost story.
Oh, yeah.
Some kind of paranormal experience.
Absolutely. Yes. I would love to compare notes with
you. Abducted by aliens, whatever.
Yeah.
Hit us up. EarthOddity@planetbell.net because we want to hear about it.
You remember you could cut this out, but you were always started the Facebook group and that lady with pictures up in there was like, and it was just like, camera lens player.
I think her name was Lisa.
Something like that. She's from Talladega.
Is she still in the group?
I don't know. We should look her up.
We need to go through the members and find her.
We just need to see what she's up to. Maybe she's listening.
Maybe she's abducted by aliens. She
absolutely could
have
been.
She may be in Zeta Reticuli by now.
I don't think she realized we were a podcast.
I don't think she did either.
Yeah. I bet you there's a lot of people who have stumbled upon us who are like, oh, this is not what I thought it would be.
Yeah.
Which is cool to me.
Well, hey, we don't care how you got here. Yeah. We're just thankful you're here.
Absolutely. We love it.
And I guess final thoughts. Actually, this is final thoughts. This is just news. But last thing I'm going to mention, do you like the 80s movie The Goonies?
Oh, yeah.
Do you like to hear geeks talk about the movie The Goonies?
Not so much.
Well, I was recently on the Retro Rewind podcast again to discuss the movie Goonies, and that should be coming up here. So if you just haven't got enough Tiny in your life and you got to get just a little bit more, you can check me out over there.
Find it a little odd they didn't invite me back, but whatever. That's okay. Yeah, that's fine.
Well, I guess you're just not geeky enough.
I think possibly the fact that I use the phrase that the guy like cucked Quasimodo is probably not the best turn of phrase to use on their podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably on me that I'm not invited back. Yeah.
You have been listening to Earth Oddity Podcast, and we thank you so much for listening to us, no matter where you get us, whether it's Apple Podcast, Google Podcast, Podcast Republic, CastBox, Spotify, iHeartRadio. We're on them all.
Everywhere.
If you would like to email the show and tell us your paranormal experiences.
Absolutely.
Hey, we don't judge.
No, I won't.
I was about to say,
you just heard me tell
John
you all about
them. Has his own.
Yeah.
You can send those to earthoddity@planetmail.net.
All right.
Do you like pictures?
Yep.
Sometimes we post pictures.
At least once a week.
And you can look
sometimes.
Yeah, you can look at those pictures at _earthoddity.
That's right.
You can tweet at us @_earthoddity.
Yep.
And we also have a phone number.
That is 662-493-2059. Let us know your weird stories that happened to you.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so call in. Tell us about the time you got abducted by aliens or saw a ghost or whatever.
We especially want to hear the stories that involve probing.
That's Tiny's thing. I'm not so much into that. You know.
We hope everybody out there has a great week. Earth Oddity for the Fringe Radio Network signing off.
Love y'all.
Bye.
This has been a very odd production. Thanks for listening.